Good afternoon. My name is Paul Frommer, and I'll be chairing today's webinar. It's a pleasure to welcome you on behalf of the Aerospace Division of IMEC-E, and it's an even greater pleasure to welcome our speaker, Marco Bosman from the Netherlands. He's the Chief Technologist for the Global Additive Manufacturing at GKN Aerospace. Marco obtained his master's degree in material science and engineering from the Technical University of Delft and has been working on additive manufacturing technology for more than 10 years, mostly at Fokker in the Netherlands. Marco, I think we can be looking forward to an interesting presentation. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Paul. Good morning and good afternoon, wherever you are in the world. For me, it's somewhere in between. I'm in the Netherlands, like Paul said. And I will speak today about additive manufacturing and what we've done and what needs to be done to put them on a flying aircraft. First, let's introduce myself a little bit more. Like Paul said, my background is with Fokker, and used to build our own aircraft. Now we are a Tier 1 supplier and part of GKN Aerospace, as it's known, group. Within my company, I did different roles in design and manufacturing of aircraft made of components. And the last about 10 years, specialized in additive manufacturing. But let's first say a little bit about GKN Aerospace, what we do, who we are. As I said, we are a Tier 1 aerospace supplier, so we supply major components to the big OEMs in the world, like Boeing and Airbus, but also the engine suppliers, like Rolls-Royce, GE, etc. This is about what we do. About half of what we do are aerostructures for the civil airframes, so wings, tails, fuselages. About one third is about engines, big structural engine components, and defense business focusing on a lot of kind of niche applications like fighter canopies, as you see here, and the other step that we are focusing on, but that is a smaller part of our business, but very important too. We are located all around the world, actually the Western world, as you see on this map, based out of Europe, but our biggest market is North America, where we have also about 20 sites that produce components for the OEMs, based typically in the US. Our growing market is actually Asia. We have a footprint there, and we are growing over there to catch up with that market, which is growing at the moment. And basically, the R&D that we are doing is based in Europe. And go to the next slide. What we're doing, a little bit of a peek into the future, what GKN Aerospace is going through. We are pretty much a technology driven company, like most of the aerospace companies are, actually. And looking new technologies to be even more higher performing, improve sustainability, etc., etc. As I said, we are increasing our global footprint, typically in Asia, and we do our innovation out of our four global technology centers, we call them. We have one in the UK, in Bristol, in Sweden, Trollhättan, in Oak Ridge in the US, and in the Netherlands, in Hoogeveen. There is where we are doing our research, and we have each center has their own specialty. What they are focusing on. And my role is into additive manufacturing. That's actually one of our technology focus points, and there is where I have my presentation about today. But before doing that, we have a nice, more corporate video where a guy who speaks much better English than I do explain more about Beacon Aerospace and what we are doing in additive manufacturing. So a movie will play the coming 4 minutes, and I will come back later.
This is waste, metallic swarf from machining processes. And in this case, it's very expensive titanium waste that comes from the production of incredibly finely engineered parts for the aircraft and aerospace industry. A 6-machine line like this can fill 50 of these every week. Just imagine how much waste like this is being produced in machining facilities like this all around the world. It makes you think, maybe there's a better way of doing things. And that's why we're here. This is GKN Aerospace, the technology partner for the global aerospace industry. At facilities like this and all around the world, GKN Aerospace is making vital parts and assemblies for the latest civil and military aircraft, like this wing spar for an Airbus A380. To landing gear retraction jack fittings. Entire wing structures, even complete engine systems. So when GKN Aerospace thinks about doing things better, there are no half measures. And sometimes it takes a truly disruptive technology to transform an industry. A technology like additive manufacturing. GKN Aerospace has established global centres of excellence like this to push the boundaries of this amazing technology, to find out what's possible, what's next. Changing an industry doesn't happen overnight. It takes commitment, investment and collaboration with academics, with government and research organisations, with strategic suppliers and with customers. So, what's driving this change? Well, there are the internal drivers of production efficiencies, cost reductions and improved time to market. And on the other side, there are the customer-led drivers, lighter, stronger, better performing, more efficient. Additive manufacturing will deliver these benefits. And less material means less energy, less waste, fewer transport journeys, and a reduced carbon footprint. It's the start of a revolution in the way that parts like these are manufactured, the way they're designed, and the materials that they're made from. It gives designers complete freedom to entirely rethink how a part should perform without the constraints of traditional manufacturing. That brings huge benefits. Remember that machining waste? Well, traditionally, this part starts life as a block of titanium that weighs about 5 kilograms. To get it to this results in 4 kilograms of waste and an immense amount of machining. Now, with additive manufacturing, we can start with just 1 kilogram of titanium powder and end up with a lighter, higher performance part and cutting waste by more than 95%. But that is only part of the story. The big benefits come throughout the value chain. Design to tooling time is slashed. Complex shapes can be achieved easily. Casting and machining processes are redundant. Even transport costs are cut right down. For this one item, conventional production could take up to 95 weeks. Additive manufacturing can cut that down to 12 and give a lighter, higher performing product at the end. So where does this technology lead us in the next 10 or 20 years? Well, for one thing, the supply chain will look very different. Materials engineering and creation will be at the heart of production. Product performance will be designed into the base material and combined within the same deposition cycle. This takes us into areas of manufacturing where design and function become the key drivers, into biomimetics, where the freedom of manufacturing will enable us to mimic the efficiency of the building blocks of biological structures, creating forms that are grown to provide the strength and performance properties that designers imagineer from the minimum of material content. Here at Filton and in the other global centres of excellence that GKN Aerospace has committed to, they're taking the latest concepts in additive manufacturing and transforming them into viable working processes that deliver tangible benefits to the business and to its customers. GKN Aerospace is truly shaping the future.
Okay, I'm back. Yes, I hope you enjoyed the video, and now you are stuck with me with the weird Dutch accent that I know I try to get as good as the actor from the video. A little recap. In the video you learned about a little bit about GKN, what we are doing, but a lot about AM, I hope, and about the benefits. Here's a short recap about the reduced material waste, improved performance and lead time and cost and a lot more. And let's look in depth to another case together to learn what we have to do to get an AM part on an airplane. So I will, next slides, I will focus on a specific case which is a bit notional, that we will learn a lot. And the example is a very small hinge bracket of an access panel on an airplane. Consists out of two gooseneck parts and some fittings on inside the aircraft. You can't see them on the picture, but they are there. That has the function of hinging the door open and close. They're not critical for flight. They're made out of titanium 6-4, a typical alloy used in aerospace structures, and it's machined out of a block. But while machining this, what we typically look at in aerospace is what we call a buy-to-fly ratio. It's the amount of material you have to buy to get a certain part out. And you see here the gooseneck part is a small light part, 45 grams, but it has to machine that out of a titanium billet. You will end up with a buy-to-fly ratio of 27:1. It means that for 1 kilo of part, you need to buy 27 kilos of raw material, to machine off 26 kilos of this material and turn it up to swarf, like you saw in the video. The fitting part is actually much better for machining. It's an even smaller part, but has a buy-to-fly ratio of a little bit over 6:1. But still, a lot. And definitely when you're looking at titanium parts, which titanium as a raw material is pretty expensive, for these four parts, the two goosenecks and two fittings, you are wasting 2.5 kilos of this expensive material, which is of course economically not a good thing to do with sustainable even this either. On the economics also, titanium is a pretty tough material to machine, so machining operations should be done on special equipment with high power spindles. with special cutters, which are pretty expensive, and they will wear out pretty quickly. And machining is relatively slow, definitely compared to aluminium. So another economical thing about this is your machining of this 2.5 kilos of titanium will take a lot of time, and is therefore not really economical. But the titanium being wasted, that's a big thing. And AM promises to slash that very big to numbers that are more acceptable, definitely for having a more sustainable footprint on materials. So let's look at if you make these hinges and goosenecks out of AM, how should that look like then? How will that look like? Now, here's an example, and what we did to make the most out of the AM technology, we also changed the design a little bit, because the design previously was designed for machining, and there was still some material in there that is not needed, and therefore we have topology optimization to get rid of the excess material that is still in the part to get finally onto a more bionically looking part which has lower weight, and because of that also less material. That's not a complete story. What you see here in the slides is the parts are now a little bit lighter, but still the bind-to-fly ratio is greater than one. That means that there's still some material wasted. And that's because of you need support structure, you need some accurate assembly faces and holes that cannot be printed at that accuracy that is needed. So they need to be machined afterwards. All in all, gives us a bind-to-fly ratio for the gooseneck of a little bit more than 2-to-1. And that compared to the original version of 27, it's a huge improvement. Same accounts for the fitting part. And on total, we are now only wasting for a complete set of hinges for one door, 120 grams of titanium. So that's an extreme improvement. That's definitely here in the order of about 2000% improvement. So fantastic achievement if you only look at the material side of it. And imagine these are just small parts. If you do that with much bigger parts, like in the next slide, if you scale it up to bigger parts, and here you see a part that we built. It's a mount ring for an engine. It's also titanium, and we used to machine that out of a big ring forging, which was already pretty expensive, and we had to machine a lot of material out of it because the forging wasn't very net shaped at all. So what we are doing is we fabricate a ring and we deposit the stiffeners on top of that, and then making a near net preform, saving about 600 kilos of titanium. So that's an enormous improvement, and that's why we are doing AM actually, which is one of the bigger opportunities. That definitely is the expensive titanium materials. So it's all looking fantastic, though. If you look at the material usage and the waste that is reduced by shifting to additive manufacturing, but it's not that easy. It's actually, there's a huge elephant in the room, and it's called certification. That's the big challenge of getting that on an aircraft, and the authorities, they know that. Let's go to the next slide. The airworthiness authorities, the EASA in Europe, and the FAA in the US has the same kind of approach. They recognize that if manufacturing is there as a new novel technology, which is very useful to get aircraft lighter, better performing, etc. But they are really hesitant in using this new technology on aircraft, and that's where, yeah, that's their job actually. It's they recognize the benefits, but they are hesitant in the implementation because what they recognize is this new technology gives huge variation in properties, and you need to prove that, your part is good enough to put on an aircraft. Definitely, part criticality is something. You will not put highly critical parts with this new technology on an aircraft. So they are really focusing on, yeah, look at the criticality of the parts, the majority of the change towards the more conventional solution, and then you need to prove that you can, that you are able to produce these parts in a reliable manner, in a controlled way, to get it safely on an aircraft. So that is not an easy job. What you see out there flying around on aircraft is not much on yet, and they're all non-critical applications. And this is the main reason. It's the authorities, they are pretty hesitant, and actually they are right on using this approach. And we are actually doing a kind of the same approach within DPN. On our technology development, because AM is still a novel technology, we are still developing it and learning as we speak, and we are developing our technologies according to technology readiness levels that has been introduced by the NASA a long time ago, but widely adopted by the aerospace industry having a kind of a step development with some clear gates, what we call 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, etc. Where here you see the ladder that you need to climb for every new technology that we are developing. And after 0, 6, we say it's ready for production. It will develop further by learning and by the industrialization much better. But what we typically do on AM is we have 0, 1, 2, 4, pretty generic fundamental technology development. 0, 5, we will make full-scale demonstrator of the part that we are aiming for. And like, for instance, we will test it on a ground-based engine test, for instance, that it will not put in the air yet. And at 0, 6, after 0, 6, we can put things on an aircraft that can really fly. But we have in 0, 6, we actually in AM, we discriminate levels in the 0, 6 tool. We start with low criticality parts that we actually use as a kind of a pathfinder to learn that these are non-critical for flight and therefore can be much easier be inserted than the critical part. But the next step will be still no criticality, but with a more complex geometry and function, and maybe a larger part. Because if you scale this technology up, the problems will rise with that, and you need to cover that too. Next step will be a kind of intermediate step towards the really critical parts. That yes, we will look at structurally loaded parts, but not at a high criticality level. Well, where we are now, we are actually in the first stage of low criticality parts that we are developing and introducing on aircraft now, nowadays. But for sure, our ambition is to go further. But yeah, the certification, that's the elephant in the room, and that's something that you need to be very thorough about. And the challenge lies in this. It's I always draw this as a kind of a triangle. But it is because your material properties, your product geometry, and your process parameters, they're all interrelated. They all interact with each other, because when you do AM, you're actually making your material while making your parts in the AM machine using your process. So how can you be sure that you are meeting your design properties? That is much different as it is with conventional technologies like machining, where you buy a block of titanium, for instance, from a material supplier, associated with a material certificate telling you what the strengths and the stiffness and all the other properties of the material are. You make the shape out of the material and put it on an aircraft, and you rely on the properties that the properties will stay the same. And well, our history proved that yes, they do in case of machining. And that's how you certify your part. Now, as a part producer, you are also a material manufacturer, and that is pretty new. So there is where we need to focus on, and that is where why the certification is so hard for every part using AM. So typically what we do in aerospace, we write down a qualification plan, and that qualification plan can be drawn like a test pyramid with on the bottom some generic test coupons like tensile samples, etc., to get your basic material properties. In the middle level, you have a cutoff of or specific elements out of your component that needs special attention, and on the top you have your full-scale testing of the part. This is kind of simplified pyramid applied to AM parts. And these test coupons, they could be generic, but it's definitely a could. It's not that is always the case, because it depends on your material source. If you change your material source, you have to show that the fundamental mechanical properties are the same. It's the same with the equipment that you're using to build a part. So this test pyramid that you are building is actually only valid for this one material source, this one machine, hopefully a machine type. But I will come back to that later. We also see within the same machine type variation. Your process needs to be fixed, so you have a fixed parameter set that you cannot change. Because if you change it, you are changing your material properties again, and you need to do the work all over or differently. And your build configuration also has some influence on your final material properties, because your thermal history of your parts can be different if you only print one coupon or a dense nest of 100 coupons next to each other, and also some anisotropy will have a role on this. So your qualification plan should cover this, and should link all the steps within the pyramids to each other to finally get your full-scale parts certified. So that's basically what you have to do. Still sounds not that hard, but I will show you there is a lot to it. To start with, the typical AM material properties variation that we are seeing, and that's recognized by the airworthiness authorities, because they write it down in their certification memos that variation is something that you need to control to be to be in control of your process, to be able to get parts from a flying aircraft. And there are a lot of sources for that could cause variation in your material properties. Is what I said already, is your material source, but also the recycling of the of this material, your feedstock batch variation. There is anisotropy in your build, so your build orientation will have an influence on your material properties. You have machine to machine variation, you have your build process parameters, your part geometry and your support strategy, that influences too your final material properties, because a thick part acts differently as a thin part because of your thermal history. Your cooling down is much different, so your microstructure will be different, etc. And you, of course, you have your post-treatment and you have many other things, and they should all be covered in your process control plans. But luckily, what we see in AM, typically in metal AM, your static properties are not that bad. They are typically equal or even better than what we used to with a plate or even forgings. But with a scatter that we need to guide. So the first picture on the top right, it's showing different batches and different machines of the same build job of coupons, and you see variation. But luckily, the lowest threshold is still better than what we used to. So that's good. On fatigue, though, it's a different story. But you see again a big scatter, and that's the picture on the bottom. You see the blue dots are the AM samples, where you see they're all on the lower part of the graph. The other dots are from extrusions and plates, and you see they're higher than the, they're better on fatigue than the AM samples. Relate that to the defects that you are building in by doing AM, by building it layer by layer, and with every layer you have a chance to make a defect too, and probably and surely they are relatively big and influencing the fatigue property as you see in the graph. So fatigue is still something that we should work on, typically when you have to go when you are looking at more flight critical parts that are critically, they're practically always prone to fatigue loading too, and that's definitely an area where we have to work on to get that on a better level than our current state. Coming back to the hinges again, these small access panel hinges. I will show you the certification approach that we did for similar parts. And this is not a small exercise. It's the project plan is as such. It's you first need to have a plan how you are going to qualify this part for flight, and here again is the test pyramid. And for these small parts, it doesn't really make sense to do cut-ups from a real part. The parts are small enough to do some full scale testing. So our test pyramid looks like this. What we need to do then, we need to write that down, what our plans are to get this one certified, and share this with the authorities, that they are aware and they can give feedback up front. When you've done that, you can do your design for 4 a.m. Typically, that is something that you need to do for every part. It will improve your business, your business case, and your process to continue when you really have the freedom to change the design and to do even little design tweaks to make it better printable. And then you need to set up all your paperwork, starting with your material specifications, your process specifications, and you need to have these all approved and fixed. Then you can do your materials allowable generation and maybe do your design over again with the allowables that you generated when they are on the lower bound, but typically you work. What we do is we design it first and just do a check that we design it conservatively with relatively low values to be sure. Afterwards, when you did all your allowable testing and they're all good, and your design is according to the allowables, you can do your component and assembly level testing and the top of the pyramid. If you did all that successfully, you could get your green light from the authorities. And when having that, when you have that, of course, you want to do, you can start production with your first article inspection into service. And you will develop further more on a kind of industrialization type of effort where you can lower your cost and make your production more efficient. But a big job within this whole process, because this project to certify relatively small and simple non-critical parts will easily cost you 1.5 years and a lot of money associated to it. But you will end up with a lot of paperwork too, because definitely, there are a lot of standards being developed by the international standards institutions that are out there in the world, like AMS, ASTM, etc. That there are no international accepted standards that we can use. So we need to make our own. But of course, we get inspired by the standards that are out there. So we wrote our own, the first two material specifications. You need something for purchasing of the powder. You need some technical process specifications, not only the AM process, but also your pre-processing, your post-processing. And last but not least, you need to write down how you maintain and calibrate your equipment. Having all this, it's a kind of prerequisite to continue. And this is actually what you need to do about halfway your project. This is not enough. You need to use this and to show that you can use it in a repetitive method. So the next step is to create your allowables. And for this case, we did not start from scratch. We had certified some other titanium parts in the past. We had and we have a lot of knowledge gained from our R&D efforts on printing titanium. So we try to make the project as focused as possible to do the minimum that is required to get these parts in the air. So we said, because they are just statically loaded, we will only do static tests. There's bearing involved too, so bearing tests are needed. And we used as most as material and data from previous work as possible. We determined some gaps. We saw that we had only fully machined parts, because we did printed parts that are machined all over. So only the machine samples were relevant for the previous work. We now, for this topology optimized part, you have a lot of sections that are unmachined. So we need to cover that. And we knew from previous work that the S-deposited services perform worse than a fully machined service. So we only choose to do, we choose to do only that. We chose to do only thin coupons because we saw in the past that thinner coupons perform a little bit worse at the thicker coupons. And the we took the worst case orientation. So in the XY plane, as you see here in the picture, when you see the Z-axis, much better properties as the one on the Y. By doing all that to get good allowables that can be used for real designs that can be put on an aircraft, we need to make a pretty comprehensive test campaign. Although we limited the amount of work because of our legacy data from other projects, we still needed to do to test about 400 test samples. And this is a typical build of tensile samples and bearing test samples. We typically need to test the 10 different batches to get our batch variation covered. And when you did all this, you get an allowable set, which is actually only applicable for geometries of 2 millimeter thick. If you have a next part which has typically thicknesses of, let's say, 1 millimeter or 10 millimeter or so, you cannot use these data because your material properties are dependent on your shape. And definitely the thickness is an important one. If you've done all that, you can print your parts. You might do some redesign with the real design values that you created in your allowable campaign. So thickening up some sections which are not strong enough with the allowables that are generated. That these are the tiny tweaks to the design. You print them and do your component testing. You see on the left a picture of a more generic test, and on the right it's a real assembly with a really composite composite panel. And there, yeah, titanium is a pretty tough material. Even if you print it, it's still titanium. It's still a really strong material. So for these kind of tests, you probably will break your composite panel, or you will pull through the fasteners that are attaching the hinge to the panel. But the titanium part will typically not break. And actually, if you have done all that, you will share your results with the authorities, and you basically are ready for to go or no go to put it on an aircraft. But during this exercise, I hope you learned a lot, and we did a kind of an exercise like this, and we learned a lot. First bullet is it's pretty hard to find a good AM candidate. I showed enormous improvements that you could gain by changing the titanium parts to an AM part, but that did not take into account the extensive certification hurdle that you need to do, because this project alone, it's a pretty expensive exercise and takes a lot of time. So for low value parts, typically your business case will not be positive. Although, if you look at the park alone, it's all fantastic. But the good news is, your first AM qualification will be hard, but the second one will be easier because you can reuse some of the data, not all, so it will still be tough, but it will be easier every time. But still, it's hard. Yeah, design for AM. Pretty important because simply changing a part that is designed for production with a more conventional technology like machining or sheet metal working, if you change that one to one on an AM solution, probably your AM solution will not be affordable. So that will be, you know, yeah, there will be a design for AM needed to get it ready for printing more easy and to get some more benefits out of the AM technology and just then the one-to-one replacement of an existing part that actually isn't designed for AM. Yeah, you need to work very close with your customer and with the authorities from start to finish. What I showed, your qualification plans, the thing that you should do first, and you should share it with the authorities that they are aware and they can give you the feedback and you will not surprise them in the end. It's really important. And what we see that is when you really want to put a part in production, and you are not alone. You have your supply chain helping you getting this part built. And what you see, typically you have two companies there in the supply chain, which causes some challenges. You have the typical aerospace company suppliers on tooling, machining, service, finishing, inspection, etc. That are used to more conventional technologies and not so much aware of AM. So what we saw on these kind of parts, the topology optimized parts, that typically machining could cause you a lot of headaches because you optimize the parts for printing and didn't care so much about machining, what you actually should have done, because if you put that later on your supply chain, please only machine some assembly faces and some accurate holes in it. They will come back to you and say, how the hell do I set this up in my machine? How can I machine this in a stable way? Because the part looks so fragile. These kind of things that you need to cover. You need to be aware of that not everybody is as knowledgeable about AM as you are designing the AM part. And there are, of course, companies who are much more experienced in AM as we are, like the equipment OEMs. But these guys are not aerospace companies, and we will we will need to work with them to get them more aerospace focus to get the right level of controls in their machine to get the certification and the quality controls that is needed to get your properties right easily into your machines, building your machines, and to have a reduced machine-to-machine variability. Yeah, that's what I would like to share with you about the certification thing. So to close my talk here is I want to make a summary. It's the certification of AM parts for airplane applications. It's tough, but can be done. And typically, what we do it with non-critical applications first. But you need to prove every time again that your material properties are in control, and for every shape you need to be sure that your properties are still the same as they are shape and process dependent. But every time you do it, you will basically enlarge the base of your testing pyramid. So what we did with these hinges, we just added the as-built non-machined samples on the bottom of our generic test pyramid, so we can use that for future parts too. We have this allowable steps for 2 millimeter thick unmachined components, which is can be of value with next step that parts that look alike. But still, what we are doing, we are practically doing a part-based qualification every time. You can take a part family of look-alike parts that have the same characteristics. That's probably fine. But if your design differs a lot from the previous one, you need to do additional testing to get it done. We're not at all there yet to get a process qualified that is so good that it can build any geometry reliably. Because currently what we see, we need to tweak the process for a specific feature. But we are learning, and we are learning by kind of step-by-step insertion of AM parts on aircraft. We call them pathfinders. By doing that, we will increase our knowledge, and we will improve our process to enable more complex and critical AM applications in the future. And last but not least, by doing that, we will unleash the real novel design solution where AM is used fully to its promise, where we can have extremely lightweight, highly performing parts on aircraft, and that's definitely the holy grail that we are seeking for. So that's the end of my presentation. There's now time for questions.
Thank you, Marco, for the presentation and the insights into the design, manufacture, and certification of these parts. We do have quite a lot of questions coming up. If anyone in the audience has any more questions, feel free to use the tool to ask these. I can't really promise we'll manage to get through all of them, but we'll give it a try. Marco, are you ready for the first question?
Yes, I got a question about do the parts have like-for-like sort of properties?
Yeah, I can read out the question for you, and then you can concentrate on answering. So the first question is from Andrew Dugan at Northrop Grumman, who asks whether the parts have like-for-like structural properties with traditionally manufactured parts, or if you found them to be stronger or weaker, so either requiring more weight or allowing weight saving.
Yes. Well, that depends on the application and on the requirements. What we typically see, and I showed it in one of my slides, is that the static properties typically are at the higher edge of the, what we are used to do with conventional technology. So for statically loaded parts, you can do, for instance, a like-for-like replacement, and they will have the same properties. The properties will be good enough. But for fatigue loaded parts, definitely there's a knockdown at the moment. We are working on improving this, so getting your defects reduce, amount of defects reduce, because typically that is what driving your lower fatigue properties. But at the moment on fatigue, you will have a knockdown and you will have to thicken up your parts or redesign it to get it good enough. But that is why you will not see or hardly see any fatigue loaded printed parts on aircraft yet.
Okay, thank you. We've got a follow-up question on this topic from John Duffel at MOOC, who asks on slide 16, when you compared the static and fatigue properties of additive manufactured parts, were these compared to wrought or to cast properties of the same metal?
What we do, we do both, depending on the application, of course. What you typically see, wrought properties, you will have lower fatigue properties than what. But on casts, we are at the same level. So you could replace a cast part with an AM part. It will prove to be at the same ballpark of your fatigue performance.
Okay, thank you. We've got a question related to this from Martin Cross, who asks, what is the typical defect size produced by this process, and how does it compare with defect sizes in traditionally pre-produced raw material billets?
Yeah, okay, yeah, good question. And this is typically a topic that we are working on at the moment, and we'll keep on working on this in the future, because you have different type of defects. You have round gas pores, you have more irregular lack of fusion pores, you might have some cracking inside. Typically what we see, you can have porosity up to 100 microns, sometimes even more, but a round defect and the irregular lack of fusion defect acts much different, and you also have the location of the defect. Is it near the surface or not? That's all things that we are currently investigating to really understand the effect that the defect has that we are finding, to be able to improve on this. So that's not an easy answer. We are still working on it, and there is still a lot of research to be done on this topic.
Good, thank you. We had a similar question from Dominic Garathy at Rolls-Royce, who asked, it seems like material porosity and flaws arising from the AM process is one of the most significant challenges for further application where fatigue performance is critical. Can this challenge be overcome with further developments, or could you give a bit more of an insight into these future developments?
Yes, this is definitely the biggest topic that we are working on for the future, and it's a pretty broad topic though. So what I first explained to my other answer was that the we are investigating the effects of defects, so all the different types of defects. We are making kind of a defects catalog and then link them to properties, so you can show the effects of your defect, and then how you control it. And that is all go into your build process itself, how you control it, do you need some more sensors on it, and how do you use them, and in the end, how do you inspect these parts. There is a lot of effort too on non-destructive testing. So yes, it's a broad topic, all with the same aim, with some different streams they are running in parallel to improve on this.
Okay, thank you. Changing topic slightly, we have a question from Ben Mason at Cardiff University, who asks how you address the surface roughness of the parts and whether this is accounted for during design or whether it's required to do some post-processing.
Yeah. That is, again, it's a case by case thing. You can go from a polished surface to a kind of non-treated surface right out of the printer. Pretty much the right out of the printer surfaces we will never use, and you will always have some blasting to make it a little bit better. But that is the range that we are considering. It's all goes with the cost, of course. The relatively rough surface, which is just a blasted surface, it's the most cheap way of getting an additive part done. But it is, you could only do it if the requirements of the part allowed it. And otherwise, you have to do either machining all over or do some chemical or mechanical polishing kind of things. So there are a lot of different ways to improve your surface quality. That's depending on the case.
Okay, thank you. And we've got a bit of a more general question from Louis Lack at Alpha Omega Business Consultants, who asks, in your opinion, how far away do you think we are from using additive manufacturing in fatigue critical components, or will we never be able to get the material performance required for these type of components?
Yeah, very good question. It's a bit of a crystal ball question, but I will try to answer it. Since I am an additive manufacturing enthusiast, I might be a bit on the positive side, but fatigue critical components, you have actually two classes of them in an aircraft. You have the most critical, the highly critical parts that if they crack, the aircraft go down. That's what we call the class one critical parts. There will be a long way to get these parts printed. So that is something that I even don't dare to put a number on it, but it will be more than 10 years for sure. But there is a clause that, yes, they are critical and they are fatigue loaded, but if this part breaks, another part will take over. So they're not at this higher criticality as the previous one. And these are the parts that we are currently looking at to get them certified for flight. But by doing that, you need to do a much more comprehensive test program, as I explained, for this statically loaded hinge. So it will take a lot of time. You will have much more variation that you need to look at. You will have much more questions to be answered because of the criticality. So typically this will take much more time. A number on it. And again, I'm a bit enthusiastic about this, so it might be positive that, let's say, a 5-year time span should be okay for having a fatigue loaded part, but not a critical part on an aircraft.
Okay, thank you. And we are running a bit over time. I'll just try and go through a few more of the questions. We've got two related questions from Adam Cotgreave about the testing, with asking about the dependency of product geometry, the material properties, how you can justify to reuse coupon testing for future products, and whether you considered actually biaxial strengths during that coupon testing.
First we only did a bit the more simple testing because that was good enough for this application, and that is also why we are starting with the low criticality parts first, that can be covered by the easier, straightforward testing. and also enable to reuse some work that we did in the past that are some lookalike parts or features that we studied in depth that are again in another part. So by doing that, we are expanding our knowledge and our proof base, as we call it, like that. But anyway, we need to, even you can use it, you need to prove it that it's valid. So there is still a step required to prove that your allowable set from a previous program is valid for your part, what you're working on now or in the future.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. I've got one final question I can ask you. When you mentioned the standards for additive manufacturing, that you were developing your own at JKN, but obviously customers like BAE, Airbus, and Boeing have their own standards. So do you need to work with them to create the standards, or how does this work?
Yeah, it works a bit in a different way, because as a tier one supplier, yes, we are supplying parts for all the OEMs with have their own standards. And what we typically do is we make our standards to comply with practically all of them. So it's a bit of a mix of all of them. But of course, if we make a part for Boeing, we need to comply to the Boeing specifications. But if we want to use the same process for a part for another OEM, like Airbus, we need to apply, use their requirements. So we typically make a kind of a compilation of all of them and put them in our own specs with our own knowledge, of course, inside it. So it's currently a mix. Yes, we learn a lot from the OEM specifications, but at the moment we need our own to cover it all.
Okay, thank you. I think we've exceeded our time for this webinar by quite a few minutes now. So I would like to thank you again for taking the time for the very interesting presentation. And I would like to thank the audience on behalf of IMEC-E and the Aerospace Division for your interest. And we will have similar webinars coming up in the future again. Thanks a lot, Marco.
Yeah, thank you for the opportunity. Bye-bye.
Bye, everybody.